Mm. I will just put it here in case I have a...
You're very busy. I'm getting the impression.
Yeah, it's this fall is a bit intense. I usually have a space between movies, but right now it's like I'm doing press on Sicario. I'm finishing Story of Your Life, and then we are slowly starting the prep on the next one. So it's a bit. I must say I'm not long hours of work, but in the same time, a deep joy of creativity, because it's a very exciting year for me as a filmmaker, because I had the chance to. I am having the chance to work on very exciting projects, I would say.
Is that your? Do you prefer to work all the time, or would you like to have a little space?
Right now, it's a bit intense. I should say that after the next one, I'll make sure that I will have a bit more time. It's not that I don't have the energy. It's more the idea that to have the time to have the necessary time to dream enough about the film before you jump on making it. You know, it's mm-hmm. like that process of dream. The dreaming process for me is very important, and right now it's like. On fast forward, but still I'm having a blast working with my collaborators right now.
So how did Canadian end up in Mexico? Was that an inevitability?
In a way, Canada and Mexico, it's North America. I mean, it's like I feel that what's happening at the border between Mexico and the United States has some links with Canada as well. It's like mm-hmm. Those are borders, but at the same time, it's the same piece of land. And I was interested by that part of the world since a while, and I felt that when I read the screenplay, I saw a chance to bring a camera there, and it was something that I was dreaming to do since a long time. So I just convinced very quickly people to jump on board with me to make that project.
So shooting that kind of landscape was what was
it's
it?
Not the landscape, yes, but more important is the idea of that border where you have you have a desert, yeah, there's a line in the sand, and on the both sides there's one place where democracy is getting attacked and the democracy degenerates. I mean, the people are losing faith in their institutions on the Mexican side, and the other side you have the most powerful democracy in the world, and the rich people and there's poor people on the same side, but they are deeply linked together, and that I felt was like quite meaningful to talk about.
And the political side of it is that something you've always been interested in, or is that kind of a circumstance of the script? Or
it's like I must say I learned a lot doing this movie about what is happening on the drug trade and on that part of the world, but. What interested me was more the impact of that reality on the human beings in this part of the world. Mm-hmm. Also, for me, the movie, I must say, for me, the movie is not about specifically about Mexico. The movie is about how Western powers are dealing with their problems outside of their border, you know, how they can. So it's a movie that could have been set in Africa or Middle East. Maybe.
And yeah, it might be. You could probably do that anywhere, yeah?
Yes, exactly.
So do you do a lot of, the script came from elsewhere. Do you do a lot of research yourself once you get the script in terms of what
the FBI
really does or the CIA really does?
Yeah, the thing is, first of all, what really reassured me is that Taylor Sheridan, the screenwriter, has done his own work. So I was not dealing the research I made after, as I was mm-hmm. prepping the movie, just confirmed what was written in the script. And mm-hmm. that really reassured me. I felt that Taylor had redone his homework. What I did, I had conversation with FBI, with mm-hmm. DEA, had a military supervisor working with me all the time. The guy that had been with the Navy SEALs with 28 years, and that had worked with the DEA for something 7 or 8 years. So I was having people knowing about that culture, about those institutions, because obviously I didn't have the time to make a university studies or you know about all the right. subject. I needed people that knew it from the first hand around me, close to me, with me all the time, and that's the way I was able to make the film about when I read the screenplay, for me, that one of the big challenges was the idea that I'm not someone who has a specific military culture. I don't know nothing about militaries, about military behaviors, or about fighting. I don't know. So I needed people around me that will be a specialist, and that's what we hired. So I felt comfortable to approach that reality with them. The other big challenge was the Mexican culture. Now, the thing is that coming from the documentary world, I'm used to immerse myself, I'm used to listen, I'm used to capture a culture with a camera, listening to it, respecting and loving that culture. And my cinematographer, Roger Deakins, is the same. So for us, it was not I felt comfortable that I would be able to do it by myself.
But it feels like a very specific piece of the culture that you guys went and shot, and that border relationship.
Yeah, but when I'm talking about culture, it's things, and it's like just having the feeling that we will try to create authenticity in front of the camera, not fall into cliches, you know. Mm-hmm. I didn't want people with sombrero playing guitar with chicken all around them. So I wanted to embrace Mexico, to see this reality, scenes from the victim's point of view. Not to make, I tried to not to create, for me the movie was not about the cartels, but they are a shadow hovering in the background of the film, but still when I portrayed those people, I was trying to that it feels like real and not ostentatory. I don't know how to say that in the word, ostentatoire. I wanted something that...
you wanted to be authentic.
Yeah, I tried to be. And Benicio del Toro as well was a good advisor for that, because he has been in contact with that reality for a long period of time, having made a lot of film and having made a lot of research about that. So he was like my guardian angel as I was walking in that territory, you know, saying, you're right now, I feel here it's too much. And we were adjusting like that. But it's always, saying all this, Sicario is fiction. It's total fiction. It's not a documentary. I mean, but when you're doing fiction, I always feel that the closer you must know about what the reality is, because you embrace, you try to recreate reality as much as possible, or at least if you go a bit far away from reality, you know that you're far away. I need to know if how much I'm lying with the camera. You know, it's true when you do fiction. Necessarily doing fiction in a way is a form. You cannot say that you are saying the truth. You're not. It's not a documentary. It's fiction. So you know to know the limit. You know to know the where you are as a filmmaker. You are in relationship with reality.
Well, I assume you don't have an intimate knowledge of kidnapping either. When you did Prisoners.
No, exactly. It's true. But I know about. Inner violence, I know about fear, I know that those things I can deal with, I can direct actors with, but it's true. I made a movie about the Middle East, that flirts with a group like Hezbollah or the Lebanon War, and I was not there. So I had to rely on research, on counselors around me, people that were helping me to bring reality, and the way to do it, I think, is to not judge the reality and to embrace it and to listen. I mean, I need, as a filmmaker, I need to listen to people around me. I need to go there with no ego, you know, and just to embrace. I mean, when we were shooting in Mexico City, very often there was things that were happening on camera that I was asking the real people to stay there, to help us to because I felt that it felt more real if they were part of the film. And I was really... in relationship, I feel, with people as we were shooting.
It kind of seems like Blade Runner is actually a relief almost from the material you've been doing. You get to create your own universe and not...
To do that, it's like it's a relief. It's another problem because you're in the dream, the world of dreams, and then there's like you have to put your own boundaries, and to create those limits, to create that world, it's a fantastic challenge and exciting, but I have a lot of respect for filmmakers that are doing sci-fi right now or fantasy, because it's not easy to do.
No.
I feel it's like and I was dreaming since I'm 10 years old to do sci-fi, but I must say now I'm It's a big challenge. Very exciting.
Well, Afonso has Chivo, and now, and you have Deacons, so you can balance it out. You can
the Roger and I, for me, it's a very extraordinary, unexplicable, surprising relationship. You know, that the fact that when I was prepping Prisoners, I received a phone call. I was looking for a cinematographer, and I remember I had made a list of cinematographer that I wanted to work with, and the number one was Roger Deakins. I remember, and then I made that list for myself, and then I took a pen and I crossed his name, saying, let's not dream that, okay? It won't happen. So I approached other cinematographer, because for me, the man was in that too much in demand and a god. And I remember I was going to LA and I received a phone call, and my producer said, there's someone who wants to add his name on the on your list, because he would love to have the chance to talk to you, because he would like to be considered to for your next project, Prisoners. And I say, ooh, and they said Roger Deakins, and I thought it was a joke. I thought, and then I had that beautiful meeting, surreal meeting, when I met Roger the first time, when I realized after 1 minute that, hey, wait, he's trying to convince me to hire him. I was like, I stopped him. I said, sir, stop that right now. It makes no sense. I'm begging you. I mean, like, for me, Roger is one of the strongest artists alive today. He's a visual genius, and it's like very strange for me that he has the will and the pleasure to work with me. I think it's coming from. He's a very strong artist. I think that we are both approaching storytelling in the same way, with a kind of a will to find the most simple and most powerful and most poetic image to tell, to approach a scene. There's something strangely, I always say to myself, it's like two very different animals, you know, like an elephant and a mice that are having a mouse that are having fun together. And it makes, I don't understand, but it's again, I'm blessed. I mean, like, every shot I'm making with Roger, I'm learning. It's like a learning process. Because everybody are talking about aesthetic. Aesthetically, Roger is strong. He's a genius with light. But for me, most of all, is a strong storyteller. How to create, how to tell a story with a camera, insanely strong. I mean, it's. So right now we are like I'm working with him every day on the making of the next project, and I'm it's the dream process to be with him.
So do you wrestle, or I mean, are you digging in together into each shot? And
yeah, the thing is, one thing I'm gonna be very honest here. When I did my first film with Roger, I realized at one point very quickly that I was dealing with someone that I knew his work, I knew his reputation, but it's something to watch someone's work, and it's something different to work with him. And I realized I was someone that I had the chance in the past to work with very strong cinematographer. And I know that I'm not bad to direct a cinematographer, I know to the language, but Roger is so strong. So I remember my wife saying to me, let it go, he's stronger than you. He's just like, yeah, so it's like it's a very collaborative process, but I just let it go. He has very strong ideas. All right, it's a fantastic, I cannot say nothing. I'm used to play tennis with the cinematographer. Right. Sometimes with Roger, he's smashing my face. It's all right, I'm not.
You know? But that's what you dream of.
Yeah, exactly, because yeah. It forced me to be better all the time, you know. But it's a very exciting project, both of us. I feel that the thing that moves me, I think, is that just that I feel that Roger is very surprised sometimes by some of my ideas that are exciting for him. So it's a kind of give and take. I mean, the way we dig with is just there's a natural movement. Now we approach our third movie together. And I can say that I'm starting to know the man a lot, and he knows me a lot. And so we approach things with the cameras in a curiously similar way. So it's like there's no tension. It's just deep creative pleasure together.
Wasn't that what you want from everybody, really, your actors too? I know your relationship with Jake was very tight.
Yeah. It's just that the beauty of, for me, one of the beauty of cinema is like having all those people dreaming about the same thing together. It's like, as an artist, if you want to have total control, then you go into your basement and you do sculpture or painting, then you will have total control. But with filmmaking, you have to work with hundreds of people and to direct them, inspire them to walk in the same direction. But what the most beautiful thing is then when you feel at one point that you're gonna get a better movie if you're listening to the good ideas around you. And when you work with that kind of level of quality of people around you, like Deakins or Benicio del Toro or Josh Brolin or Emil, sometimes they have fantastic ideas that are better, and that I have to, as a director, to put my ego aside and listening to that and be the channel for the better idea. At the end of the day, the movie must win. The winner is the movie, it's not my ego, you know. So it's the ideas. And that's my Sicario for me is, when I finish the film, it's my best film. I don't know what other people are thinking, but for me, I said that thinking that I was able to do things in that film that I had not done before technically, but also how I was able to channel everybody's creativity, to bring Benicio and Emily on board with me, to be partners that will brainstorm with me in a way that I never experienced before, where I felt we were a team. And that sometimes I was making shots saying to myself, that shot is one of the best shots I've made, but it's a product of everybody's best qualities. I don't know how to express that in English, but
you're doing really well. So it was the Emily character. Is that the hardest thing in this movie? I mean, it seems like finding the right tone.
It was very difficult because the thing is that it was her character. The way Taylor described her is it's a character that is like will disintegrate in front of the camera slowly. And will become more and more vulnerable and will challenge more and more her own moral values and her own moral certitudes. And it's tough to portray to that. And we will embrace her point of view. So the audience will embrace a point of view that will lose more and more its power and certitudes and still this point of view will be the one of a woman, and she will be the only woman in the movie. So the thing is that it was important to make sure that she will not looks naive, that she will not look, she will be manipulated, but she will not look stupid. You know, there was something very, very delicate equilibrium. I need an actress that will have that strength to be able to go through that journey and to make that kind of moral striptease in front of us, you know, and to be conflicted lost the horizon in front of our eyes slowly. And it's like, but still that we will embrace her point of view, that we will want to follow her through that journey. And that's very tough to do, I think. And Emily did an absolute fantastic job, because the people who will see the movie will understand that, will realize that she doesn't have a lot of things around her to do that. She's just a witness, and she doesn't have a lot of dialogue. Everything happens in her eyes, and all through all those 3 days that the character will go to, the journey that the character will go through. She did a fantastic job.
So is that something you always had on set, or did you have to find some of that in post? Or
no, it was a concern we had in prep. With Emily, from the start, we went through each line of dialogue. Say, how can we bring that line, embracing the strength of the character and trying to give her space to express, to love the character. So it was a concern I had on each scene to take care of her and make sure that it will make sense at the end of the journey. It's not something that I was able to, that I would have been able to do it on post. I needed that performance on camera. Of course, on the editing room, I took care of Kate. Yeah. But because I know that at the end of the day, she will have the two other figure of the movie, played by Benicio and Josh, will be very powerful, and they will get, as the movie is moving, as the story is evolves, their point of view will get stronger and stronger and stronger. So I needed to take care of her in that regard. Yeah.
So do you, are you a person who finds much in post in terms of the story or the what that you're looking for, or you really know the movie when you get into editing and you're just putting
it together? It's a very good question. I think that movies are all different, but I feel that I'm a director that find it's a movie. I'm finding the movie as I'm shooting it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm prepping, of course, like the preparation and the shoot. The movies that you find in post, it's very painful. It happens to me twice in my life because for reasons that their screenplays were not, there was failures in the screenplay. And mm-hmm. when you read, it reads well, but when you incarnate, when it becomes, the words are coming out of mouth of real actors, and you look at the screen and there's like something confusion. And then when you have to do, post to solve problem in post is not I don't like it's nightmare. I rather arrive, sit in a very comfortable in the editing room, knowing that I have a strong story in my hand from the start. It's not no. So I should say I'm a director that I think things happen as I'm shooting. Yeah.
And you're
it's important what I'm said because I'm taking the liberty as a director mm-hmm. in my process. I become in a way a dictator as well, saying that I take full control, meaning that if when I want to remove lines, change dialogues, if I feel with actors that the movie will be better if we go in a specific direction, I take full responsibility, but I change things mm-hmm. on as I'm shooting a lot. And that I know that I'm right when I'm doing this. And that would be my answer.
Well, you have these big audacious sequences in all of your films. And are you comfortable that you've got them when you shoot them? Do you know that it's going to cut together and be the thing? The dark sequences, which I think everybody's still talking about, when they're in the black.
Oh, yeah.
Is that scary to go shoot that and then have to go look at the dailies or figure out whether...
No, it's super exciting because it's like, when you shoot with someone like Roger Deakins, Roger is like my guardian angel. You know, he's every shot I'm making with him needs to be justified and explained to him where it's gonna go. It's like really, I love this process because it helped me to be very, very rigorous. Mm-hmm.
You got it because Roger knows you got it.
Yeah, maybe, but when you make a film, you are always doubt in the same time. It's very scary when you shoot a film that you're dealing with chaos, you know, and you're trying to organize chaos in front of the camera and mm-hmm. To make sense out of it. There's always a few moments when I'm shooting and say, okay, I have a movie. I know why, because I know we nailed something with the actors in front of me. And I know that there's always some specific scenes. Say, if I got that, I need that quality there or that emotion or that idea that will come out in front of the camera. And there's a moment I go to bed and say, okay, I have a film. I know it in my heart, you know. But until I have those, I feel that I'm very afraid. Like the sequences that we shot in the darkness, it's like something that was very planned. The choreography was very precise. It's a scene that, of course, needed editing to find to find the right equilibrium and the tension mm-hmm. into it. Joe Walker did a fantastic job. I mean, all the elements were there, I think, too. Mm.
And is somebody like Joe, who's a very... He seems like a very kind of relaxed guy for an editor. He seems very kind of like happy and...
He doesn't have a choice because he's working with a melodramatic kind of director of that is always a, I'm a bit Italian style, you know. I exaggerate all the time. I shout. I cry. I like to work with Brits.
So it's a balance.
It's a good equilibrium to work with someone like Joe Walker, that has a strong artist. Someone that sits in the editing room and has a weight, you know, a weight. He has I love how confident he is. I love how he can create tension with length. That's why I was really attracted. I saw his work that he did with Steve McQueen on Younger or Shame or 12 Years a Slave. And for me, it was those three movies. One thing that struck me beside the performances were also the editing. How he was able to stretch time, to create tension with long shots. And that's exactly what I was looking for Sicario, you know, that kind of tension. And I just fell in love with that editor. He's the best editor I ever worked with, and he's a very strong artist. And I wish I would make all my movies with him. I'm trying to, very strong artist.
And fun to go to dinner with, I'm betting. Huh? And fun to go to the bar with and dinner
with. Yeah. Very fun new guy.
So as you get into Blade Runner 2, which I think seems like most of your interviews are leading with that.
Yeah, these days, that's a bit normal.
It's all everybody wants to talk about. But are you, has Ridley kind of just said, it's yours, go run where you want to go?
Ridley was very generous with me. First of all, the first thing when they approached me for the film, I said there was one major condition was that I will do it at one condition, and it's the first thing I said to Ridley Scott. I said, I will do this movie if you give me your blessing. Otherwise, I'm walking out right now. If you don't say, it's okay, Denis, because I knew it was its own project. Mm-hmm. It's one of my own pet project. Blade Runner is and when you dig into the anatomy and the creative process of the original Blade Runner, Ridley Scott is everywhere. I mean, the design, shot, everything is the ultimate artist behind Blade Runner, of course. And I needed to have his blessing. And and then he said to me, basically, what he said is that I could ask for his help anytime, that he will be there, but he will. Otherwise, he will let me free. That give me the wheel, and I can drive the car as I want. Mm-hmm. And that is the best scenario for me. I feel, of course, I want to keep him in the loop as much as possible, knowing that he's super busy. Right now, in the process, I need time to make my own, to digest the project and to make it my own. Mm-hmm. So right now I'm pretty in my own bubble, making the movie with Roger Deakins right now, and dreaming about it with my production designer. And we have the most intense and beautiful project of my life right now, because it involves everything I wanted to do with movies, the cinematic poetry, strong subject, and sci-fi. And it's very, very biggest challenge of my life, but at the same time, very exciting.
But I'm guessing that you don't carry the kind of weight that something like Star Wars 7, 8, 9, 10, whatever they're making. I mean, there's this whole move back to old franchises that they're rebooting.
Yeah, that's
it. I'm guessing you're not going to spend your entire time paying homage to what Ridley already did.
Yeah, it's like the movie needs to be as its own, find its own identity. But in the same time, it's in relationship with the first one, but it has to have its own identity, and that I'm confident we have already found it. Mm-hmm. In the same time, I must say, I was convinced at the first place by the script that Ridley Scott, Hampton Fancher, and Michael Green wrote a very strong screenplay. So that had already its own weight and its own density. I understand what you're saying. It's true that there's a kind of the things that were alive when I was younger are coming back right now, and it seems that I will be part of that movement, and it's a strange feeling. But at the same time, Blade Runner is a movie that inspired me to be a filmmaker. Mm-hmm. It's one of my, by far, it's on my the top three with 2001, Space Odyssey, and Close Encounter. Those are my three top movie that brought me to make that job today. So it's like, for me, I was not able to say no to that privilege. Yeah.
And are you in shock that things have gone so quickly for you? Your career has just kind of blown up, and you make films that are challenging. It's not like you make films that are popcorn films or very easy audience films.
I pinch myself about, you know, as a filmmaker, I was always like trying at home when I was making movies in Montreal to be faithful to my voice, and I was not making any compromise. And I was saying to myself that I will never be able to work in Hollywood because they will never want to work with me. Anyway, I was not dreaming to come here because in my mind, in Los Angeles, there was a line of 25,000 directors waiting in line to get a project made. And I said, I won't be the 25,001 guy at the end of the line. I cannot. So I was very, it was a coincidence. I was like invited to make it. I must say, I deeply love making movies here because it feels here when you make a movie with Americans that filmmaking for Americans is an important art form. It's very, it's something I don't have the impression to be a gypsy making a circus. Like when I make movie at home, a filmmaker are strange animals. Here, it's a real job. and the thing is that it's very, there's a lot of, there's things. You know, the border battle in Sicario is more expensive than all my movies I made in Montreal before. It's like just one scene.
Right.
There's things that I can do here that I cannot do at home. At home, I can shoot two women drinking tea, talking together. That I can do is another problem, but to make a border battle, I need to have the power of Hollywood to make those kinds of movies. And as long as I will keep my identity and my freedom, oh boy, I love making movies here. Yeah.
Well, you're doing pretty well with it,
yeah.
Say the least. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Pleasure.